up when we arrived, so still in a deep form of sleep at this stage. We might have to be a little bit patient for them to start waking up. But you can see that they are battling a little bit with the flies, so even though we're going towards winter at the moment and the temperatures are starting to cool, the insect activity is still very high and lots of biting flies around and lots of ticks still. So that's why the ears are moving so efficiently all the time and twitching. It's just to get rid of those flies as they land around the ears and particularly around the face and nose area. But you can see how social they are. And a lot of you are commenting how cute the little cubs are. Indeed, they are very cute, but they're starting to lose that cub look, aren't they? They're starting to look a little bit more like adult lions. They're getting those features and everything's starting to grow into the size of their ears, and their paws is all starting to get less and less and more proportioned in terms of their body. So they're starting to look a little bit more sub-adult and far less cubby as we're going along. And it's amazing to see how big they are. Vian was asking me if I think that these cubs are actually the same size as Hosanna. And I think maybe they are. They actually might be definitely Shongile size. They might be a little bit bigger than Hosanna, though. They're getting to that stage, and soon they will be, that's for sure. You can see the spots are fading as well. So they really are getting quite big now. Ah, so many of you are complimenting Viem on his lovely camera work. He is good, isn't he? Viem is one of the best. It's always a pleasure to be working with Viem. He really does do a very, very good job and moves the camera around with such grace and ease. So well done, Vildi. Very good job. But that is a picture of pure content behavior. They are absolutely loving the shade, and I don't think they're going to go anywhere anytime soon. I think we're in for a long afternoon of sitting and just watching and waiting and letting them do their business before we're able to actually see that they're going to stand up and move around. And I actually think with the heat that we've had today that they're only going to get going probably late this evening. But let's see. It's worth being patient for and seeing what's going on. We're also in an area where there's lots of traffic of other animals. So we're along a drainage line that leads up towards Arethusa Dam. On the other side of us, north of us, is a little pan called CF's Pan, where zebras often like to go and drink. And so maybe one of those animals comes walking through here, and that will pique the lion's interest, and we'll see a little bit more movement from them, and they'll actually start to get up and move around like they were this morning. But it is quite difficult actually to make out one from another at the moment. They're all stacked up together. Kristen, you're wondering about the mange on the cubs or whether or not it's gone. If you have a look at that one cub at the back there, you can see on its elbow there's still a little bit of sort of scabbing that's remained. So while it is not very bad at all, there is still a little bit there, and it's slowly but surely diminishing. So I would imagine within the next little bit, probably a few months, 3-4 months, we'll see that they'll be completely healed. They've really come back from it and bounced back, and they're looking in far better condition than they were even 2 months ago. So I think they'll be just fine. And the older they get, the stronger their immune system's going to be, and the more that they're going to be able to get rid of this mite. Also, as they get older, they start to lose that cub sort of mentality of always having to be right up next to one another, and you'll find then the mite is not going to spread nearly as easily like it does with the adults. The adults, you can see, and they lie apart, they actually are in far better condition, so they don't spend nearly as much time in close proximity to one another. And so when that starts to happen, then the mange should clear up, but it is infinitely better than what it was a few months ago, that's for sure. Oh, and a big stretch there. It's that kind of afternoon. It's a siesta afternoon. I think it was much like that in the Juma today. And everybody was kind of having siesta this afternoon. So it feels like that kind of day. And the lions are doing it very, very well. Auntie Lynn, you're wondering if all six are here? Of the cubs, they are. So this morning we had all six here. It's just that we can only see four at the moment because they're lying off a little bit to the right as well. We've got some in a thick bush just off to the right, which are the other two adult females. So where the sun is shining there, just behind that bush, is where the other two are. You can actually just see the back end of one sticking out there. It's quite difficult to see, but there is one in there, and then another one around the back of that bush. So all six are here and accounted for, which is good news, and all are looking healthy and fit. There's no limping individuals, there's no issues with any of them. They're all looking quite good. So all is well. The youngest cub that we have, which was looking a bit skinny earlier in the week and looked quite thin, is even looking a little bit better. Maybe it got the lion's share, so to speak, of the impala that they killed. And you can see it's the one on the back right there. So you can see that its hips are still a little bit protruding, so it could put on a bit of weight. But I'm sure what's happening with that cub is, as we've gone into summer and they're no longer feeding as heavily on things like buffalo, and they're having to rely on impalas and probably not nearly as often as they were in the winter months, there's a little bit less nutrients, and then the body is fighting this mange that they've got, and so it's utilizing a lot to try and get rid of that, and that's why it's probably a little bit skinny. But they'll be fine. You know, we now almost at the end of the summer months, and so there should be a bit of rain coming our way, which would mean that in all likelihood, I mean not rain, sorry, a bit of dryness coming our way, which would mean that the buffalo are going to get a bit weaker, and therefore it will be much better for the lions. Right, so we're going to sit this out and wait and see how they do and whether they wake up or not. And while we do that, let's go to a rather more active being in the form of Steph on his bushwalk.
Have a look at this erosion ditch from the rains. Just isn't it incredible that the amount of rain that we had, it wasn't even significant. 60 millimeters is definitely far less than what we can get. We can get over 100 millimeters on a rainstorm, but look what it did. I can't wait for it to rain again. I'm gonna come straight back here and have a swim underneath this waterfall. I think it's gonna be quite nice, don't you? Nice to see these things, eh? Right, now Craig's got to try and jump up over there, so he's probably just gonna lose me for a second while he balances. Craig, you just felt what it felt like to be a klip springer, which is an antelope that occurs over here that is well renowned for being able to jump up almost vertical cliffs. But that's not why we came here. We came here because there's a tree that I like to visit. Today's definitely been a day for big trees, mainly because we can't find Karula. I haven't given up just yet, but we are walking around in circles where we think that she is. Hopefully we get to find something. The biggest clue that we had, of course, was that smell of that dead tortoise. We thought that we had nailed it, and then we got there and that bank that had fallen on that poor tortoise had killed it. But wow, have a look here. And I've got something to show you. Awesome. Look at this hole. Can you notice the axe marks on the hole? So what that is where man has chopped open and maintained a beehive. Now, I've only ever found another one here at Juma, also in a Tambuti tree, not too far away from here in actual fact. So it was probably the same honey collector. So what's happened is that hole there has a cavity in it. The cavity would be a brilliant place for bees to come and make a nest, but it needs to be maintained. It needs to be widened so that the honey collector can smoke the bees out and collect the honey. And you can see the tool marks on that tree there. That is definitely tool marks. Oh man, that's epic to see. And because there's no damage to the tree, I can see nothing else. It must have been made ages ago. Now, man has been living here for ages. While that could have been the marks of a stone tool, I doubt it. I think that looks like an axe, a steel axe. And to chop a tree like this with a stone tool is virtually impossible. This Tambuti wood is very, very, very hard and would have posed a bit of a problem for Stone Age man. Not that you couldn't do it, but I think it's an Iron Age site maintained by one of the local honey collectors. And I don't think it was now. And the Sabi Sands is one of the oldest reserves in the country. At way over 60 years old, there hasn't been people living inside the confines of the reserve for way over 60 years. And before that, people were living over here, but it was seasonal because in summertime, lots of grass, of course, but disease, malaria has been rife over here. And in wintertime, of course, there's not enough surface water. So people would move in good years, move out in bad years. It would be a very sort of marginal area for people to live in. But obviously, there's been a honey collector. And how sad is it that nobody here remembers who that honey collector was? Now, Peter, you've asked me what the oldest living tree is in this area. I'm going to say it's probably this very tree. Or one very close to it. There's a leadwood that grows on Leadwood Drive. That's the biggest leadwood. I think just two or three shows ago now, yesterday or the day before, we showed a leadwood, an absolutely enormous leadwood. That's probably the oldest tree here at Juma. It's also the biggest leadwood that I know that's growing. But this Tambwati, and there's another one further down here that's about the same size. They're the biggest Tambwatis on the property. And this Tambwati and that leadwood are probably about the same age. I would say anywhere around 600 years old. Perhaps a little bit older, perhaps a little bit younger. The only way you'd really know is to carbon date it. And that means to drill a hole in here and then to date the carbon 14. And apparently, if I get my theory right, there's a compound that changes into another compound, and take me on my word for this, and basically leaves behind some element, and they measure that rate of decay of these compounds, and that gives a very accurate age. And they'd be able to basically tell you how old this tree is. Now Tristan, who's also being fed what we're saying at the moment, says that there's a leadwood in the Mulwati that he feels is the oldest leadwood. Tristan, probably, I mean, I'm going to agree with everybody over here. I think that I don't know every tree that's growing at Juma. I know a fair amount of these big trees. I could probably take you to a selection of the oldest trees, but to answer the question, the previous question is, which is the oldest tree? It would be a leadwood in this area or a Tambwati. Definitely one of these two, this one, another one, or that leadwood. But what is absolutely fascinating is that beehive that we've managed to find over here. Wow, these flies. Let me see if I can get up here and have a look inside without getting mumbled in the face or falling off and breaking something. So absolutely been chopped inside there. Leslie, you've wanted to know, do we have any non-stinging bees? Leslie, we absolutely have non-stinging bees. By far and wide, the majority of bees that we actually have out here are non-stinging bees. And if you want to see a picture of one, I think James used to play with some non-stinging bees inside a giraffe skull. And I think there's probably our community would be able to send you a few links to James's bees that he was showing also underneath our microscope in the tent. And you'd be able to see one of the species of stingless bees that we have over here. We do have stinging bees as well. That is what makes these honeys, or this honey. And would have, it's so interesting, you know, the axe marks just go in this deep. And then there's a cavity. And it would have been very difficult. I think you'd have to probably have to have scooped out the honey with a tool of some sort, probably a stick. I don't think this honey collector got much honey from here, to be honest. It's not a big deep cavity. Would have had to chop in a little bit more. Just so cool to see. Oh, I think I'm going to come and climb this tree at a later stage without my backpack on. I feel like I want to. I could climb right to the top of this particular tree and stick my head out the top, but I don't think I'm going to do that now. I'm going to take my backpack off first. Also, I'm a bit dehydrated from my walk today. I want my brain in full function before I go and climb to the top of a tree. I am almost 40 years old, of course, and my wife would be shouting at me right now. Awesome. Now, we're still looking for Karula. We've expected that when she gets moving in the cool of the evening that we'd start to hear we'd at least start to hear animals give alarm calls like they did last night, which is why we think she's somewhere over here. Last night when we said goodnight, we were looking at a giraffe, and behind us there was a group of impalas that were going absolutely crazy. Now, we found where those impalas were a little bit earlier on in this walk. We tracked the area through and found and backtracked the impala, but couldn't even find one single footprint of this particular cat. She's being very elusive at the moment, which is typical of Karuda. Anyway, while I try and throw myself off this tree without breaking anything, we're going to send you over to Tristan with those lions.
Well, as I predicted, Steph is far more active than our lions. Our lions have really not moved very much at all. One little cub got up and plonked itself down in about two steps. So it's about the sum total of the activity that we've had so far. The sun is now just starting to dip below the horizon, so I'm hoping as that goes down that we're going to end up with a very, very beautiful sunset, one, and two, with some lions that are going to start waking up. It is quite nice that the sun is going down. It's also gotten a lot cooler, so I'm hoping that these lions are going to be a little bit more active shortly. We're also going to have some other vehicles joining us. Some of the commercial vehicles are going to come and have a look at the lions, and they are coming in. So I think maybe when they come in, one or two of the cubs might put up their heads and we'll get at least a nice view on them as they do so. But isn't that the picture of absolute happiness and comfort? That is one sleepy little cub, that's for sure. You can see those noses are still very, very pink, but the blackening is starting from the bottom and along the edges. Slowly but surely they're starting to get darker and darker. And so there was a long time where they used to use the nose as a way of aging lions or leopards. They say that cats' noses change color, and that is mostly true, but I have seen multiple different cats whose noses stay pink even as they go into adults. There's a female leopard in this area called Moya, and her nose was pink until she was about 6-7 years old, so it's not really a true indication of age, but it is at least one of the signs that they could be aging, is as that nose starts to darken up a little bit. And you can see, there we go. So as VM just said, Shadow, who is quite old already, she's got a very pink nose as well. So Shadow is about 9 years old now, VM. It's about there. Her nose is very, very pink. But look at that cub. You can see that cub's nose is much darker than the other one that we were looking at just now. And this is the one of them that has got the very deep amber eyes as well. So there's two of them in this pride. There's the young cub, then there's that one, and then of course there's the original amber eyes, which is the adult female who is missing today. She's not with them. It's just the three females that are here today. Now I wonder where she is. This morning we found tracks for the Birmingham boys, three of them. They were eventually found on Simambili Elephant Plain side, and it looked like in amongst those tracks was a track for a female. So maybe that's where Amber Eyes was last night, is with those boys, and she was walking around, and then when they pushed a little bit too far west, maybe she turned and went back this way, and so she's maybe hanging around somewhere here. I haven't heard of anybody calling any tracks for them, so I'm sure they are around though. But that is the picture of absolute happiness, and the two in the back are starting to have a little game together. They were pushing one another with their paws, but it seems like everybody's comfortable again, and back to sleep we go. Now you can see that during the day today, while it's been warm, they actually haven't moved very far, and on their chins, which VM was showing you there, there's no sign of any matting, which means that they haven't drank today. So I would imagine that when they do decide to wake up, their first port of call is going to be to find water, just to rehydrate themselves after a long day of being warm and hot and probably panting a little bit, which would have led to quite a bit of moisture loss. So I reckon that that's where they're going to go first, is maybe to this pan that I was talking about just north of us, drink there, and then from there continue on the evening's hunting exploits. But this is about as far southwest as I've ever seen the Nkuma pride. I've never seen them really push too much further than this. I've seen them a little bit further northwest of this, but never this far southwest. We're now right into the Salalas area, that Salala breakaway pride area. Used to see the Salalas this winter. This was all the area that they used to hang out. So we used to see the Salalas here quite extensively, and they used to be very, very commonly seen here. Now they've shifted south a little bit, and it seems the pressure from the tortured pride has led to the Inkahumas actually pushing into this area now and making use of this Arethusa Dam, Arethusa Lodge, and then the south and around the airstrip area. So it's going to be interesting to see how that plays out if the Salalas do come back and they find these Inkahumas here. Hopefully, with luck, this Inkahumas won't be here, because those young males in the Salalas are now big enough and strong enough to potentially kill these cubs. So it would be a bit of a disaster if they did run into each other. Better that the Inkahumas stick around further to the northeast of where we are. But there you can see a bit of that mange we were talking about earlier, particularly around the hind legs. There's a little tail that's sticking out, still got lots of little spots on it. It's amazing how some of them differ. And it's much like our little hyena cubs that we have in the den at the moment. The one's far less spotty than the other one. Oh, look at that. Look, big, big, big yawn and stretch. And you see the size of those paws, as well as there was just a little hint of those claws coming out. And you can see how big and curved they are, and damage that that would be able to do. Now the size of that paw is probably easily the size of my hand or the circumference on my face, so it would be quite something to be hit by that. I would never want to be hit by a lion. Imagine the power that is involved in that with those big strong forearms. It would really be not a pleasant experience, I don't think. Well, Lynn, this is probably quite an interesting one. You're wondering whether the cubs sleep more deeply than the adults. Well, I don't actually think so. I think the thing is that when the cubs are younger, and even now, they're far more alert to their environment because they are far more scared of what goes on around them. So they're nervous of sounds and noises and big objects moving, because they know that that could potentially be a threat. So you see when a vehicle approaches, often the females don't move, but the cubs pop their head up and they're curious to see what's going on, and they watch what's going on, and they know that they have to almost be that way if they're going to survive. So that's their survival instinct kicking in, that as soon as something approaches, they can then quickly get up and move and get out of that area and try and avoid being killed. So probably not. The cubs probably don't sleep as much, although when they are very small, you find that they kind of drink and then they just pass out completely, and they are almost very tired, and they tend to sleep a little bit longer than the adults do. But I don't think they sleep as deeply as what the adults do, especially big male lions. Big male lions can pass out, and really very little wakes them up. Right, so our Inkahumas are still sleeping, but Taylor has managed to find a beautiful herd of elephants, so let's go across to her and see what the elephants are doing.
We're still with our friends from earlier, but something seems to have upset them, because the rest of the herd ran, or raced across the road is probably a better way to describe it, and are now all pushing and shoving deep into the thick vegetation. We're probably going to lose sight. Let me move up a little bit further. It's just these two are the last ones behind the herd, and you know, the smallest thing can honestly upset an elephant. Oh, I'm not sure what's done that, but look at this cute little calf. It's missing its tail. Hopefully we'll get another view of it if mom pushes out of the way. And I really think that that's the most unfortunate thing to lose when you're out in the bush, is your tail. Now that's a very old injury. You can see that it has completely healed. There's not really even any scarring anymore. And that could be from a number of different things. Maybe it was born like that, who knows? It could have lost its tail. Maybe it got into an altercation with perhaps another elephant, or maybe there was a stampede and it fell over and it broke. You know, you never quite know. And I've actually seen a lot of footage in Botswana and in Zimbabwe of elephants missing tails, and it's often from lions, big prides of lions, that will go after is smaller elephants. But I feel sorry for you, little stumpy elephant, that you don't have anything to swat the flies with anymore. That's very sad. But off they go. And I went to check the hyena den. David and I went to have a look. But sadly, there isn't anything over there. It's not active. active this evening. You can't win them all though, but we're going to continue. We'll see what else we can find as the night is starting to come upon us. Let's go across to Steph, who's got the tallest creature in Africa.
We do actually have the tallest creature in Africa. This is the African giraffe. And this is a female giraffe. And what is weird is that at the same time yesterday, we also had a giraffe. Yesterday's one was a bull giraffe. Today's one is a cow giraffe. And just look how beautiful she is. And just like yesterday's one that was in tip-top condition, she's also in tip-top condition. Just look at that. Healthy, skin healthy, body healthy, nice and round tummy, fat muscles. Hello there, girl. Looking very awesome. Wow. Hello, Melinda. You're a new viewer, so welcome to the Safari Live family. And you're wondering if we have giraffe here. And of course, that just hopefully answered your question. We have giraffe here. They've been missing for a few months. Well, it seems like we go through patches where you don't see a giraffe for ages. And then all of a sudden you have a herd that moves onto the property. And you get to see them until they move off and go somewhere else. Let's go around the corner over here. I can spy another one through the bushes. Not just that female, who's very relaxed. But we've also got another one here that's in the bushes. Let's see if we can get you a view of her as well. Oh, you know, I take back what I said about the flies being a bit of a plague, not being a bit of a plague this afternoon. They've managed to come out in force here this afternoon, late now, as the sun goes down. Where are you going? Here we go. Just see the head through the bushes over there. That's a youngster looking at us with a lot of interest. I love giraffe faces. They've got no nose, of course, because they would hook on the branches that they stick their face into to eat. They're very fond of acacias, which have hooked thorns. And having a nose would, of course, make it quite difficult to stick your face into a bush. So they've got a very sleek and slender nose. But their lips, if you felt a bicycle tire, so a giraffe's lips feel like a bicycle tire, one that's not inflated. They're hard, they're just as hard as that. Got a very velvety tongue, a very soft tongue, except the tongue also feels like a piece of rubber, also hard. So soft coating, velvety coating, but quite hard. And they use their tongues almost prehensile to grab and lick leaves into their mouth. They grab it into their mouth and then they strip the leaves off the branches. See if we can get into the open and see a little bit better. Giraffe like it when they can see you. That's a youngster, definitely. Probably about a year and a half. Now, Sita, you want to know how I can tell a male giraffe from a female. And it's easy. I can even teach you how to do it. You look at the top of the horns. And you'll notice on this particular giraffe, the top of the horn is tufted black. Now, if the tuft extends all the way to the top, as that one does, it's a female. If it's bald on top like I am, then it's a male. So male pattern baldness is how you tell male from female. If it's bald like me, on top of the head, but has a fringe of hair around the side, it's a male. If it's got hair all the way to the top and looks like a paintbrush, then it's a female. Quite nice, hey? It just got a little bit uncomfortable with us over there. We're in that giraffe's alert zone, which means it stopped doing what it was normally doing, and it's now alert of our presence. And you'll find that it'll move a step or two, move a step or two, as long as we don't go any closer. If we even took so much as another step forward, I think that giraffe might even be spooked enough to run away. Oh, these flies that I've got buzzing around me at the moment, maddening. All right. Now, Peggy, you've asked me if giraffes make any kind of noise. They absolutely can make a noise. If they're highly stressed, they do make a rumbling, roaring noise. They've got apparently a range of noises they can make. And then recently, I just found out from some of our viewers that giraffes make a low humming noise at nighttime in particular. Not quite an infrasound, but definitely a low frequency humming noise that they make, possibly to keep in contact with one another, possibly as a, I don't know, a comforting mechanism, just to let the rest of the herd know that I'm okay and everything's okay in the dark. But they make a low humming noise at night time. First observed by zookeepers who used to spend time in giraffe pens at night time. Isn't that incredible? Fascinating. I didn't know that at all. But it's nice to know that giraffes do make sounds. In the wilderness, under normal conditions, you don't hear giraffe making noise at all. So they have this, there's this old wives' tale that they are unfortunately mute, but that's not the case. They can make a noise. Here comes the adult giraffe now into the back. The baby's going to go and join mom. You can see how big mom is compared to baby. Kelly, you want to know if giraffes are known to charge, or you're making a statement, aren't giraffes known to charge? Kelly, yes, they will charge to protect their babies, and they can inflict a terrible kick. They've got the animal kingdom out here, the hardest kick in the animal kingdom. A giraffe can put a massive amount of force into a kick. Definitely kill a lion with one kick. Would they charge me without me provoking it? No, they're not going to just unprovoked charge me. And even then, giraffes are fairly nervous of people. But if I had to run up to a baby giraffe, for instance, there's no doubt that I'd elicit a charge from a more aggressive giraffe mom. And you don't want to be kicked by a giraffe at all. There you can see how, she's a full-grown giraffe cow. A male will top her by another 3 or 4 feet. Right. Where I used to work, it's in Ngita. Lebombo, on the other side of the Kruger National Park, lions fed almost exclusively on baby giraffe. And here it doesn't seem like that's the case. In any case, we just see the Nkuhumas that Tristan is with eating buffalo. In any case, while we're talking about lions and Tristan, why don't we send you over there to go and have a look at what they're up to.
Well, we're just repositioning quickly because a anti-poaching helicopter came over, and that caused some of the lions to get up and move into a different spot. So I'm just going to try and get us into a good place where we can see them. But indeed, those lions that Steph is talking about at Ngita Lebombo were quite something. They used to hunt all kinds of large game. It was such a big pride. I remember when I first saw the mountain pride, which has gotten a bit smaller now, but the mountain pride at that stage, there was, I think, 38 of them in the pride. Now imagine a pride of 38. We get excited when we see the Nkuhumas with the five lionesses and the six cubs, which is only 11. And that's, I mean, a third of what that pride at Lebombo was. So it's pretty incredible. Now I believe that that pride has diminished somewhat and is not as big, but there's another pride called the Shishangeni pride, who's also gone up to close to 40. Now, getting to see, the grass is so long that actually when they lie down it's quite difficult to see them. But there's two of the adults there. They've come out into the open, and maybe that helicopter coming over was actually a good thing. Maybe it's going to wake them up, and we're going to see some of the little cubs and lionesses starting to get up and groom, and hopefully then get onto the move. Like I say, I'm pretty sure that they are going to head for water. It's that time of the day where they often will, especially after a very warm start that we've had today. But aren't those eyes amazing? They've got such incredibly pretty eyes already. There's one thing about the Nkuhumas is that all of them have really quite pretty eye colours. You've obviously got the amber-eyed female, and then the other females have this light, very pale coloured eye. And it's, when they look at you, it almost feels like they're cutting to the deepest part of your soul. It's quite a special thing that they have, and I really enjoy watching the Nkuhuma pride. They are a beautiful group of lions, and it's quite typical in the summer months. They often look a little bit more scraggly than they do in the winter months. The winter months is obviously the time of plenty for a lion pride. That's when animals weaken and hunting becomes much easier. Also, the grass tends to brown up a little bit, so it becomes a little bit easier for them to camouflage as compared to now with the green. Their coat color contrasts against the green a little bit now, so you know they do much better in the winter months. And so you find generally in winter also there's a lot less ticks, that their coats look in better condition, and they tend to have a lot more weight in the winter months. So they will be fine, they look good otherwise. Like I say, they really are quite a pretty group of lionesses, and quite large as well. They big girls. I see them having a little play session now. The two little cubs are starting to have a little play. And this is what happens. Is what happened that we had them earlier this week was exactly the same thing. Is the little cubs were the ones to wake up first, and they started to be a bit boisterous and play with one another, and eventually they come over to the females and they irritate them enough that they drive them to stand up, and then the process goes until the females start to move, and then all the cubs then file in behind and follow as they move along. But look at that, it's just a mass of legs and tummies and tails and heads. It's quite difficult to make out one from another, but in there is five different little cubs all packed against one another. Ah, Rebecca, very good question. You're wondering why they have black fur behind their ears. You would think that it would be a bit ridiculous, given that they're trying to conceal themselves, and that really stands out, and it helps us to see them, no doubt. But the black fur is there for exactly that reason, and is exactly why it's behind the ear. So when a lion is hunting, and it's going to be facing the prey item, all that prey item is going to see is the front of the lion. It's not going to see any black on the ear at all. Those ears will be flattened and facing forward towards that prey animal, so they're not going to see the black. But all the other lions behind them, so the other females or the cubs, they will pick up that black very, very easily, and they'll be able to position themselves accordingly when they're hunting. And then when they're moving and they're not hunting, the little cubs can see their mom up ahead, particularly in long grass like this. You can imagine when you're just off the ground and you're a tiny little cub, it's quite difficult to see where mom is. And those big black ears help for them to be able to follow their mom. They also have that black tip to the tail, which is exactly the same use that the ears have. Look at that, a little bit of affection amongst the adults. Now, I wouldn't be surprised if that sparks one or two of the cubs to start coming in and doing a bit of the same. And this is very common display when the lions are starting to wake up for the evening. They come and they groom one another, and they just get their coats back into good condition again before they start their nightly walk. So it's a good sign for us. It means that at least they're starting to wake up a little bit. And it must feel quite nice with those rough tongues. It's almost like being brushed, and they get to all those hard to reach places that you can't get to. It's like when you have an itch in the middle of your back and you go scurrying off to somebody and you ask them to try and get it for you. It must be much the same when they groom each other like this. Also, you'll find that the ticks around the ears, they help get rid of those and keep the ears in good condition. You can actually see the female closest to us. Her edges of her ears are quite tatty, and that's because of ticks. Mostly they go onto the edges of the ears and they feed off, she just shook her head. They feed off those edges and suck the blood, and as they get bitten off, so little bits get pulled off, and the ears over time get tatty and very, very worn. There we go, she's up again, and let's see where she goes to now. There's also some yawning from one of the other lionesses, so I'm hoping that they are going to get up and move. Now, when they do move, I'm hoping that they're not going to move back in an easterly direction, because if they go towards Arethusa, we unfortunately can't follow them, because there are some guests that are having an afternoon in that are quite close by to where we are, and so we can't follow the lions any further than where we are now. So hopefully they go in a northwesterly direction, and it will be much easier, then we'll be able to follow them for sure. Oh, look at that. Imagine having 180 kilograms flop down on you. Can't be the most pleasant experience, and definitely a rude awakening, although that female didn't seem to flinch at all. Now you can see it's just rolling over. I'm sure there'll be a little bit of grooming again. Ah, Reese, interesting. Well, I'm not 100% sure that color has anything to do with it, because generally the color of their ears, well, the black on the backside maybe, but the color on the ears on the inside, which is where the flies tend to go, has got anything to do with it. I would imagine heat is a very good example of it. That's why. There will also be a moisture that is secreted through the wax and things like that, and that is why they go inside there. They're after all of that. Also, there's very little fur in places there, so they can actually get to where the skin cells are, and they can mess around very, very close to the surface of the skin. You might find they're even gaining a bit of moisture that's coming off from the ear itself, so that's why they go in there. You'll find that they also go towards the eyelid areas where there's exposed skin on the nose, and if the mouth is open, often along the gum line areas and onto the tongue. So anywhere where there's some exposed skin and not too much thick fur is where the flies like to head and try and congregate. Although I say that, and you look on the rump of that one lioness, there's just flies all over it, so they do land in everywhere on these lions. Now, you can see what I was saying just now about the cubs coming across and starting to groom as well. So one by one, we'll find that the little cubs will probably end up here, and soon all of them should be with the adult females. There comes another one. Oh, look at that. Isn't that sweet? Always the best time to be with the lion pride, which is when they're waking up and they're grooming, and there's so much affection amongst them. It's such a nice time of the day to be with lions, and always see the best parts of them and the bonding that goes on. Now, Stephen, you're saying as the cubs are coming here and the lionesses are standing up that they look quite hungry, and you expect that they're going to be hunting tonight. Well, Stephen, I'm in the same camp as you. I agree. I think they're going to definitely be on the lookout for food. I know for sure that they killed an impala last night at about 2 o'clock in the morning. It was seen on one of our dam cams, and unfortunately that impala got distributed between the masses. But when you've got six cubs that are growing like this, I think the lioness has probably got very little of that, and even the cubs themselves, it would have been not very much food for so many lions. So they definitely on the lookout for a meal. They're going to be looking for anything like zebras or wildebeest, and if they're really lucky, something like a buffalo that they can get hold of. That's what they really want to be after, and hopefully they will find what they're looking for tonight. But in summer, you'll find that a lot of the time the lions do look like this. Hunting becomes much harder. We also have just gone through a full moon phase now, and when it's full moon, the lion's success rate dips completely because of the brightness of the night. The full moon comes up and everything is much easier to see, and so the prey animals see the lions a lot better. So you always find during a full moon period that lions are really not nearly as successful as they would be in a new moon phase. So now we're dipping out of that full moon into new moon. Hunting will become a lot easier, but they will hunt smaller animals like impalas to try and tide them over until they can get access to things like buffalo. And at the moment, as you've seen, if you're a regular viewer, that we're not seeing very many buffalo recently, and that's because it's summer now, so there's a lot of food and water everywhere, and most of the buffalo have moved into different areas. They've gone up into the Manyaleti and central parts of Kruger, where you get really great species of grass that grow there. And that is very, very palatable, and so the buffalo spend large majority of their time up in that area. And then as we start to come into winter, so that grass resource gets exhausted, and then they start shifting down into the Sabi Sands area, and we start to get the herds coming through, and that's when the lions will take advantage of that. But that is one big pile of lions all mashed up together there. Oh, look at that. Isn't that amazing? It's so cool to see these guys together. Akagi, you're wondering why the Nkuhumas have been so much in the west lately. Well, it's because they are getting pressured by the Torchwood Pride. Now, the Torchwood Pride is a pride that comes in from the Kruger Manyaleti area and the Torchwood property, which lies to our east, and they're a big pride. There are 9 females and 10 cubs, so there's 19 in that pride, so it's a very, very large unit. And don't forget that these Nkuhumas have also been split, so it's just been the 3 girls with the cubs, which means when it's 3 females, they are in no way going to be able to defend themselves against 9. And you can see that the Nkuhuma females, a lot of them have got little scrapes and cuts on them. So I think they had a bit of a run-in. You can see on this female on her flank there, you see there's a few cuts there. Oh, she just sat down now. But let's see on the other female. I know there's one that's got quite a bit of scarring also on her left flank. So there's a bit of scarring at the moment. So I think they had a run-in with the Torchwood Pride, and that's pushed them further west. Also, the Birminghams have finally started pushing west again as well. During the winter months, they didn't come anywhere near this side. So they've also pushed west, which means that these Nkulumas will be hearing those Birminghams calling around them, and they know that this is a safe area for them to enter if the Birminghams are calling, because they are the fathers of the cubs, and so that's maybe why they've pushed a little bit more. Interestingly enough as well, the Salalas are absent. The Salalas were around this area, and they seem to have gone further south and ended up more into Londolozi side, which has created this gap for these Nkulumas to spend quite a bit of time, which is not ideal for us. It would be nice if they started coming back towards Juma, but at least we do have Arethusa and we do get to see them fairly regularly. Now, I've just turned on my lights because it's starting to get very gloomy. And so what we're going to do is go back to Steph so that he can say his goodbyes, because we don't want him out in the dark, even though I reckon he could make it and survive a night out here in the wilderness if anybody could. But let's not test the theory, and let's go across to Steph so he can say goodnight.
Thank you very much. I don't know, I think by now I'd like to be tucked up in some shelter somewhere along the line with a fire roaring next to me. We've had a pretty epic afternoon over here, I must be honest. We've been trying to find Karula, but in so doing we've managed to uncover a few secret places in the bush that I didn't even know was here. And that's nice to know. It's nice to know there's still places that you've never explored in the bush. But it did require us to do a proper march from here back to the relative safety of quarantine open air, which we should get to in the next sort of 2 or 3 minutes or so. But from there, we should be okay. Right now, every shadow is a bit jumpy. It's a bit irresponsible to be out at this time of the night, but we were quite close to camp and we decided that we'd walk it. I don't recommend that you walk around in the Kruger at all. And yeah, that's it. So I think now has come the time for me to say goodbye. So from myself and Craig and Herbie, at least, we want to wish you a happy day wherever you are on the planet, and you're off to Taylor.
We're still driving around, but we have a bit of an issue, and I have to stop, and I'll tell you why. It's because David and I were doing some chopping. We were removing trees from the roads that were overhanging, so I need to quickly clean the bonnet, or the hood of my car, just so that I can get rid of all these wood chips from the bush willow that we cut down. It's not, I'm now blinding myself. This is how we clean the car, clean the car, clean the car. This is how we clean the car every single day. You gotta keep, you can't have a dirty hood. It's gotta be nice and shiny. And we'll just remove all the decoration, all the leaves and sticks. David, how's your shirt? Do you not have wood chips down your shirt? I did as well. I had to do a little boogie woogie to try and get it out. There we go. That's a bit better. Nice and clean again. What do you think, David?
Good.
No, I'm just showing. I didn't really spit on the car. So I think that would shine it quite nicely. There we go. Well, let's get back in again. And we've got to plug ourselves in. Oh, that feels much better now. It's been bothering me for the last couple of meters. I thought, let me do it quickly before I forget. Now, it's not quite dark enough to use a spotlight. I reckon the next 5 minutes we'll be able to pull one out. And then we shall start the search for chameleons. Because if we can have a chameleon every single night, that's quite nice. And we're going to start missing them in winter. Winter, they're going to disappear. They're not too fond of the cold weather, and so are the tortoises. So we better start making the most of the reptiles. Because I can promise you, we'll definitely miss them with a few months as winter dawns upon us. Right, let's... Where are we going to go, David? We're going to jump onto Bubbles of Cutline. Right. Let's go into the cut line, and then I think, David, we haven't been on Hyena Road in a very long time. Or no, you know what we'll do? Let's go down Gowrie cut line, which is not too far away from here. And then we'll weave away along Central, and then we go up Bubbles Hook, go east along Hyena Road towards Bubbles Hook cut line. And then we'll go via the dam, and then we'll come down in Yala Road, Because that's still the area that Herbert thinks that Karula is lying about, though we're uncertain because we haven't had any tracks or any real sign that she was around. It was just sort of squirrels and birds alarming, I think, yesterday afternoon. So maybe we get lucky. On Inyala Road North, there are those lovely pans as you get to the junction of Central, which would be a good spot to drink water. But there's also lots and lots of water in the Mulwati. And there's actually open spaces on the bank that we'll be able to have a look and shine a spotlight down, which will be good. All right, let me dig for it. Let's see. Almost, not quite yet. It's not really doing too much just yet. So we'll just hang tight for a bit with our little LED lights. And maybe we're going to see some nice insects tonight. This is always a good road to see any beetles and scorpions and solifuges that are perhaps crossing the road. And we'll keep an eye out for them. I've got my scorpion light too in my camera box. So just in case we do see one of those, we'll put it under the UV light. Louise has now just shouted in my ear, yay, I'm so happy, because I won the scorpion light at our Christmas party. We were playing, what is that game called?
Secret Santa.
But then you sort of get your gift and then you fight for it. And there were many tears, people were crying, friendships were ruined because of that game. It's quite stressful, and I didn't even realize that there was a scorpion torch until Louise waved it around, and I was like, oh, I need that for my part of my guiding kit. So I snatched that from her. I don't know, Louise, what did I trade you? I kept trading Louise something not as great. I think it was a charger, portable, a power bank. So it was a power bank. Now Louise is telling big stories. She said that she actually bought that scorpion torch. So that was her gift that she bought. So we get a set amount of money that we need to buy a present for, and then it gets wrapped up and put into a big pile. And anyways, I don't know if I believe Louise for a second though. So she said she bought it and then she was always hoping that I was going to get it. I think there's some big stories going on over there. What did I buy? I bought a power bank. Louise, I think actually you got my present. So yeah, power banks are very useful when you're out in the bush. Right, I'm excited. Let me see I better not talk nonsense. That scorpion light better be in here. Let me find it. Let me dig inside my bag of tricks. I'm pretty sure that I had it in here, but there's so much. Aha! Here it is. There it is, and you'll see it's got a purple light. You can't really see it too much, but that's it there. So now we need to search. You didn't really do much. It just got that one. Ah, I thought there were more settings. Right, let's put it back in the box so we don't lose it. Come on, scorpion, where are you? Surely we're gonna find one. Okay, I haven't seen a scorpion for quite some time. It's been a while. We used to see them in camp quite a bit. They'd crawl over your toes. It was always a joke in camp. It used to be scorpions. Someone would sort of announce to the table as we were having dinner, and everybody lifted their feet off of the ground. And then it went from scorpion to centipede. And now we're not having to shout anything at them all because nobody comes to visit us. We had a couple of big crickets though, making a bit of noise. But no one's really too worried about a cricket crawling over your feet. Oh, and Gregory. When Gregory the tortoise comes in at breakfast, we have to shout, Gregory, watch your toes, because she seems to want to eat toes. I don't know why she has the taste for human toes, but she goes after them. It's quite ridiculous. Okay, let's try again with the spotlight. It looks like it could be dark enough now. Yes. David, are you ready to see a chameleon? I feel like when I say that, I normally spot them, but now I won't because I've jinxed myself. Silly me. Let's have a look here. The cut lines always seems to be good for chameleons. You see quite a few. We just need to hope that they're on the right side of the road. I would like to see a small chameleon tonight, one on a piece of grass, but I suppose I'll just take any chameleon that I can get, but preferably a little one. Right, let's scan here. No, you know me, I'm always one-sided. I don't look on the left. I'm going to turn that light off now. David, you can only look on the right-hand side. Bit of focus. Oh my goodness, that bird gave me a heart attack. There was a bronze-winged courser on the road, and of course I'm looking elsewhere now. Luckily it's got wings and it's quick off the mark. Nope, that's not a chameleon. Woo! Come on, birdie. Tyrone, you're wondering if my scorpion torch makes scorpions glow. It does. It's a UV light. So you get that nice purpley greenish color, which we will go into. Hopefully we can find a scorpion so I can show you and then explain it to you, which will be much better doing it that way. So we shall wait and I'll keep checking the grounds. Normally we see a lot of scorpions just after the rain as well. Wait, let me fix that. Okay, right, we had our first turn off. Here we are, down Gowrie cut line we go. Let's see, I haven't been down here in ages. At one point, this was the road that we used to drive all the time. But last year when the Nkuhumas used to live between Gowrie cut line and Hyena Road, it was unbelievable. We were almost guaranteed every time we came to see the lions. And well, speaking of the Nkuhumas, you've been watching them with Tristan. They're awake now. They're on the move.
They are awake, but they have gone into an impenetrable fortress of bush. You can see here where there's a massive dip in front of us, and they should be coming straight towards us. They were over that way. The last time I saw them was while Taylor was linking to us, just dropping down and coming straight towards us. Now, the problem is that inside here, I'm pretty sure that there is water. I don't think they'll be coming outside of that. But let's see, I'm hoping that we're going to start seeing heads popping up coming towards us, because straight behind us is a really big pan that they can potentially drink at. So unfortunately for now, there's going to be one of those games of hurry up and wait and just see if we can actually see them. It's no ways that I can negotiate getting down here. It's just far too steep, so we're gonna have to just be patient and wait it out, which is just fine. It's not the worst thing in the world. Now, I believe Taylor was singing a song about cleaning. She actually is very good at cleaning. You see how clean my lovely dashboard was this afternoon? That was all thanks to Taylor. While I was sitting doing my checks before our drive this afternoon, she came along with her cloth and her spray, and she was cleaning in a frenzied hive of activity, and it was very fun to watch. So it's the first for me. Definitely not required either, because I'm quite capable of doing it myself, but Taylor wanted to get it done and to see what was going on, so she managed to clean everything up, which was good for us. Now, there is another vehicle that is trying to help us, because we're all trying to see where these lions go. But like I say, there's no way to actually get down here. Now, I'm going to stop blinding them. So I'm going to turn off our lights quickly on that side, because there they come. See them there, Vium? I don't know if you can see them, but they're just coming through there. There we go. Now, they're slowly coming our way. Hopefully they're going to go drink at a pan, because if they drink at this pan, it is going to be spectacular. We should get a beautiful reflection of all of them together, which would be quite something. And that picture of them all lined up along the bank would be very nice, although it looks like one is starting to drink down below here, which means that there is water down here. So I wonder if they're all going to go line up there. It looks very much like it. But there we go. Come on, come through. No. Right, I'm going to just try reposition us quickly, see if I can get a better view on them. Because it looks like they have decided to drink below us here, which is not exactly what I envisioned in my drinking thoughts. I've got to be a little bit careful here because of the amount of logs that we have. Nope, we're not going to be able to get down there, I don't think, Vim. Let's see quickly. Yeah, they are straight below me. They're coming up this way, which is actually perfect for us. It means we don't actually have to go this way. There they are. So, let's just see if we can try and squeeze through this little gap. We're right there, Vim. Go straight out in front of us, and it looks like they're going to come out onto the road. So I'm going to go towards the road, where we're going to get a much better, clearer view of these lions and stop messing around in the thickets.
Now, I had an interesting report now as well that the Birmingham males are also up and moving and they're coming straight east. Now, I don't think they're going to get to where we are before we finish this evening, but they definitely are on their way this side. So maybe for tomorrow morning, we'll have a bit of luck and be able to actually see them. But look at this, you see the lionesses leading what's going on, and then the little cubs coming from there. Hello, guys. Go. So let me get out of frame there. But you can see some of those scars there on the left side of that female in front. She's got a few, and look at her testing the wind. So she's busy smelling, trying to see if there's any sign of any animals that could be close by that she could potentially hunt. And then you see they stop and listen, so they scent the air. Come out into a little open clearing, listen a little bit, try pick up any sounds that could be around them. So this is them in full-on hunting mode. They're looking around for food items at this stage. There's a female that's coming past us here, so a little cub that should come past shortly. Now you can see that they are quite close, but it's perfectly okay. They're not paying any attention to us at this stage. Hello, little one, are you coming to see us? You can see there's one there just walking past as well. Oh, are you going to lie down right here? See, she's going to have a little itch. So a nice little itch on the ear there before we carry on. It doesn't get more special than that. To have all these lions surrounding the vehicle is quite something. So you can see there, they're all just now in front. It is quite spectacular to have them. The atmosphere that surrounds them, even though they're not the big impressive males, they still have this aura about them as they walk around the vehicle in the darkness. It's quite something. Now the cubs have all laid down, they're waiting for mom. So they take the cue from the females. As soon as the females start to move, you'll find that the cubs will then start to move. Now the problem is they are starting to head in the wrong direction. They're starting to move now towards Arethusa Dam, which, like I was saying earlier, we're not going to be able to follow them if they do. So what we need is for them to go straight north over the road or to try and come back to the western side. If they start heading straight east, we literally are right in front of Arethusa then, and we're going to have to say goodnight and leave them there. So I'm hoping that they're going to continue this way and go into the bush and be able for us to then follow them up that way. I see some of them are lying down now, and the females are still watching around and looking as to what's going on. I don't know if maybe they've heard something, because they are really focusing very intently to the north here. I wonder if there's maybe not some impalas close by. In this area that we're in, often on this open clearing that we are up here, you'll get impalas, zebras, and then there's a lot of nyala that come off out of the drainage line section that's off to our right where they've just crossed through. And so maybe there's some of those around, and then there's the odd buffalo that hangs around this area too. So maybe they're going to find one of those. Right, I'm going to just reposition ourselves again so we can just get ahead of the females as they walk here. So they seem to be moving up and out of the road, which is great news for us. It means we can continue with them as they go about this evening movement and see if there is any signs of anything in front here that they could potentially be hunting. Trying to find a gap here that I can get in. It's amazing to me, the last time I was on this road was in November, and this area here, I remember tracking shadow here, it was so open, there was not one blade of grass. You could see every single little footprint that she had moved and walked, and now it's completely different. Now it's long grass, can't see anything. It really is quite amazing. And isn't that spectacular with that beautiful evening light over the tops of the trees there? It really is a beautiful evening and the perfect conditions for lions to be hunting. When that sun goes down a little bit further, and I see there's a big bank of cloud coming over the Drakensbergs, when that goes down even further, it's going to be a dark evening. The moon will only rise in the early hours of the morning, so they're going to try and make hay, as so to speak, as the sun shines, even though there will be no sun. But they're going to try and hunt now while the moon is, before the moon comes up when it's at its darkest. And if that cloud rolls in, even better, because it's going to become very gloomy out here and perfect hunting conditions for a pride of lions. The other nice thing is there's not too much wind, so it's very, very still, which means if there's no gusting wind, then generally their scent doesn't carry too much, and they're able to then hide away effectively and not being given up by gusting blows of wind. And look at the rest in the background there. You can't even see them. The rest of the pride is just on the right side of this bush here, and in this long grass, there is absolutely no sign of them. So if I shine my light, you'll see the tops of their heads there. But if I take the light away, you can see very, very difficult to actually see them. So that's why walking around at night, and why I was saying why Steph should be back in the lodge, is because of this. Barbara, you're wondering whether the cubs are too young to observe a hunt? Well, no, Barbara. Last night, I believe some of the viewers were able to catch the action of them hunting an impala, and all six cubs were there. So they are starting to observe hunts and starting to see what's going on, which is great news. They're getting to that age where they need to start watching and learning. So you'll probably find what happens is the females walk with them towards where they're going. They spot a prey item. The cubs will then lie down, and the females then proceed. And they watch what's going on from afar. So they see how the females are moving, and they'll be learning from that. They'll be seeing how they position themselves and how they create the opportunity to hunt. So they are at that phase now. They are starting to learn how to do this, which is great news, because it means in about 3-4 months time, we should see them starting to try and actively hunt with the pride. Now, they're probably a bit small to actually bring down anything of serious size, but you'll find things like impalas will be of fair game to these lions when they reach about a year, year and 2 months old, and they will start participating in those hunts. In terms of buffalo, that'll be a while still. These guys won't really get involved too much until probably they are around 2-2.5 years, where they will have a significant amount of weight, particularly if there's any males. Well, we know that there's one male in here, then the rest will be able to help out a little bit later. Then normally the females start to really help on the buffalo hunts at around 2.5-3, whereas the males already at 2 with their bulk are able to do so. So it's going to be interesting times ahead, and hopefully it will be very, very rewarding ones for us as well. So we're going to carry on with them now that they've sat down a little bit. We're going to take this opportunity to go and see what Taylor McCurdy's up to and see what she's busy cleaning now, and then we'll see where the lions go after that.
Don't worry, Tristan, my OCD hasn't got me that bad this evening. I'm done cleaning. Just the hood of the car. Now, we've just arrived at the pans here at Inyala Road South. And as you can see, there's nothing here. Not even a frog for us to have a look at this evening. It's very, very quiet. There's a couple of spiders, though. David, can you see them just where in the middle of my spotlight is? It might be a bit dark on the water, yeah. There we go. There's one. You can see it. Just moving it. Oh, it's actually still now, but that's a fishing spider, and there were quite a few of them. And the reason how I spotted them was, you can't see it, but you can actually see the reflection of their eyes with the spotlight, which is quite amazing. You can't see all 8 eyes, but you can definitely see a reflection of one. Oh, well, that's a pity. Should we have a listen? The nightjars have just started calling. It's very, very eerie out tonight. Very, very quiet out here. There's very few things that are calling. Just the occasional call of the fiery-necked nightjars. So we saw a square-tailed nightjar the other night. Perhaps we'll try and find a fiery-necked. How does that sound, David? Mm. Yeah, we're still on our search for the chameleons and the scorpions and the Karula and her cubs. We're still looking for all of them. And luckily, I think if you have more things that you're looking for, hopefully you'll have a better chance of finding one of them. Let's hope that rings true this evening. David and I actually did see a chameleon already, but unfortunately it was so far off of the road we couldn't get there. Hiron, you're wondering where the frogs went. Now, they should start chirping again, maybe a little bit later. It just depends. With all the water drying up now, a lot of the frogs have moved on, and some of them will even burrow through these winter months. So they sort of estivate. So for instance, the bushveld rain frogs are known to dig and will sort of go into a temporary stage of hibernation, I suppose, during the winter months. But these pans don't seem to be too active. But I'm telling you, if we had to go to Shubamwa, it's quite far from here though, we would be lucky and we definitely hear some frogs chirping. Maybe we'll go past from here. We'll try and go and sit on the dam wall and see if we can hear the frogs chirping at Vuyatela Dam. They definitely are around. You've just got to know exactly where to look. Now remember, we do have, it is Frog Day on the 20th of March. So I don't even know what day that is though. What are we, it's Saturday today, hey? And it's the 18th, so it's Monday. Monday is Frog Day, World Frog Day. So I hope you're looking forward to that. That's going to be quite exciting. I think we're going to go jumping around in some pans and see what we can find, which I'm sure will be quite comical to watch myself, James and Tristan bounce about in water at night. You can only imagine the things that are going to go on, but don't imagine too hard just in case we disappoint you. We're not that funny. Insects getting into my mouth as usual. Come on, Nightjar. Just saw one. It was just sitting up on the stick, but it flew away. Goodness. Just scan here. Come, chameleons, bush baby, where are all of you tonight? Now, Lynn, you're wondering if we check our rooms before we go to bed for creepy crawlies. I do. I'm not sure about everybody else, but I most certainly, before getting into bed, if it is cold enough to put a duvet on, I shake it. Because you'll be surprised as to what you can find in your bed. I check my pillows. I always check around the window to make sure that there's nothing on my blind, a scorpion or anything like that crawling about. And I always check my shoes before I put them on too. But that's just me. That's just how I've grown up. I've grown up on a farm for most of my life. So even though we didn't have big wild animals like this, we used to see snakes all the time. Snakes in the house, scorpions, spiders. And you don't want to be bitten by one. I'll tell you a very funny story. It's funny now. My whole family and I, we've been going to Kruger for many, many years since my younger brother and I were really tiny. He was still in nappies or diapers. And I'll never forget the one night my mom came into the room quite late. We'd gone to bed quite early and my folks had obviously stayed up chatting. And my mom came into the room to say good night and to just double check on us. And I was awake because I just never sleep. From a very young age. So I was sitting up and I think I was maybe reading a book or playing with a toy, and my mom went to check my little brother who was sleeping in the bed next to me, and he had a massive baboon spider on his face. Can you believe that? It crawled in from somewhere and ended up on his face, and I didn't even know that it was there. So she started screaming, and then she caught it in a wine glass, which I thought was quite funny. So she managed to scoop it off him. And I mean, the spider is just very placid. It was just crawling around, not doing anything. And so she caught it and she put it upside down underneath the wine glass, and the next morning my brother was so chuffed that he'd had this big spider crawling on his face. I don't know how I would have felt about that, and that's actually something that I'll never ever forget. I think that was the first time I ever saw a baboon spider, and where I'm from we don't really see baboon spiders. We see rain spiders, which sort of look a little bit similar, not quite as hairy, and a little bit longer legs and not quite as robust body that that a baboon spider has. So that was quite interesting. So yeah, so that was my brother's experience with a baboon spider. I don't even think he really remembers that. I'll just never forget his face when he came running around first thing in the morning with his wine glass with the spider inside. He was very happy about that. Boys are strange things, aren't they? David, your type is strange when you're little. Louise says she agrees that the boys are strange when they're adults too. No, you guys keep us entertained. Thank you for keeping us entertained. Louise, please may I have that question again? Hi, Impala. David, should we have a look at these guys in infrared?
We can do.
Because what we're going to do, I'm going to try and sneak up to these impala and see if they don't run away. And we're going to actually switch to infrared and have a look for a change. Don't, guys. Don't move. Are you ready?
There.
David will let us know when he's ready. We'll just sit and wait for these impala. Oh my goodness, the bugs. Right, have a look at this. So there are the impala. Now, Rachel, you're wondering what I'm going to wear for Frog Day. Phew, that's a good question. I actually don't have any frog things. I'm a bit sad. I would have definitely liked to have dressed up like a frog. Perhaps Jerry can make me a mask of some sort. She's quite talented in the art department. So maybe we'll do something like that. But I haven't got an idea. And even if I did know, I don't know if I'd tell you. I'd like it to be a surprise, rather. But how interesting is this? You see these boys at night, and you can see that they're much more relaxed. I can't see anything with my naked eye now. We're sitting in complete darkness. And look at them. Normally, when we have the spotlight out, you'll see that they obviously run away from us, which is not great. And there they go. Hello, boys. They do look a bit strange, don't you think? Look at their eyes glow with that UV light. Not the UV light, the infrared light. Now, they can't see this light either, so it's not affecting them at all. It's not great for photography, of course, because it's pitch black, but it's just amazing to watch animals as they are so relaxed. There goes the other one, darting off. They got a bit separated there, and he looked like he got a bit of a fright. So this is what we're actually seeing a lot of at the moment, and I was chatting about it the other day. As the rut comes around, we're starting to see sort of big impala rams hanging around the favorable spots. Now, we're at Chele Pan. That's where Chele Pan is, down in that corner. And actually a little bit further to the right. Is it? Yes. It is down there somewhere. It's just a bit difficult to see with there not being much light. Right, should we carry on?
Yeah.
Are you ready to change?
Yeah.
1, 2, 3. Look at that. Amazing. Go, David. You're so clever. So we're going to start to see the battles between the impala now, which will be quite exciting. Remember, we had that amazing sighting of two very briefly fighting, I think it was at Shibamu Pans, which was quite nice. It was one morning, which was really quite nice. So I'm very much looking forward to getting some action, some boxing matches between the various animals, hopefully between some elephants, between wildebeest and between impala, of course, will be quite exciting. It's just another thing that we have to look forward to. And I wonder who's going to be the first one to see a proper boxing match. I hope I am. I quite enjoy watching them have a go at each other. And also just to really realize how strong the animals are when they push and shove each other around. Come on, this is a good chameleon area. This has got lots of overhanging branches for them to sit on. And I believe that you all love that sighting with the infrared. But what we'll do is we'll go to the dam now, as we'll park on the dam wall, and we'll have a look if we have enough time. I don't even know how much time we've got left. But I don't think it's very much, which is quite sad. So I suppose these things, all good things come to an end. We've only got 6 minutes. Okay, David, we're upping the pace here. You ready? We can do it. Let's go. We're not too far, but we do need to just put foot slightly. And then hopefully we'll hear some frogs. I can't hear anything just yet. Oh, wow. Okay, we're going to go across to Tristan. He's got a bird of night.
Indeed. So it's not a nightjar, but it is a beautiful spotted eagle owl that is perfectly perched for us, just watching what's going on. Now, there is actually two of them. There's this one that is on the tree next to the road. And then there is another one here in front that is making friends with the scrub hare, although I'm sure the scrub hare... Oh. Hello, scrub here. This should be quite interesting. Now, I know that Verreaux's eagle owls will often catch scrub hares, but I've never seen a spotted eagle owl go after them. So let's see what happens. Oh! I think the owl got just as much of a fright that the rabbit actually got that close. Well, not rabbit, should I say? Scrub hare. Naughty Tristan. But look at that. Now, I wonder... It looks like it could be a youngish one. I wonder what it's seen flying there. There are lots and lots of insects about. You can see around the owl itself every now and then an insect flies past it. So there's a few alets, a few moths, and I'm sure that's what it's making its meal out of. That's why they're on the road, is it's easy to catch these things around here, and that's why they're here. So very, very cool. It doesn't look like any young ones. It looks like both adults. So this would be a pair together, which is great to see. It'll be worth following them around for the next few months and seeing how they go. I know that these guys generally normally nest at the beginning of summer. So around October, November is when they normally start to nest, and their chicks are normally born around that time. Let's see if it's going to go up and grab something. See, it's following the antline. I don't know if you saw the antline just buzzing through the light. Here it is. There, it's just landed. So it's landed on the road in front of us here. Somewhere there, VM. There it is. So that's what it was watching. Actually, it's a click beetle that's landed there. So it was following a click beetle flying past. And so I think there's a lot of different insects that are busy entertaining this owl. Careful, little moth. You're going to be next if you get too close. And the other one on the tree is also very spectacular. There's a beautiful sighting of this one here. Much closer to us, and you can see a couple stars in the background there as well, which is quite nice. A very, very, very pretty way to finish our drive. Now, some of you may be wondering what happened with the Nkuhumas. Well, they were lying down where we left them, so they were busy going for their second round of sleep. Although they were watching towards Arethusa Dam. So if anybody is watching the dam cams, I would suggest watching Arethusa Dam cam tonight. I'm pretty sure the lions are going to make an appearance there. And there was quite a few impalas when I quickly shot past that area, in that open area. So I'm pretty sure they are going to hunt those impalas. So if you want to watch the Nkumas in being active, the Arethusa Dam cam is where I would hedge my bets tonight. Right, we're going to leave these owls in peace and in darkness and let them carry on with their night. And while we carry on, let's go back to Taylor, who's got a very cool sighting of elephants in infrared.
Isn't this amazing? We're having so much fun tonight, and I'm so glad you got to see some owls with Tristan and a scrub hare giving an owl a fright, which is, well, something I haven't seen before. But yes, we do. We have got elephants at night time, and look how relaxed they are. Again, I cannot see a thing. It is pitch black. The light that you can see that's catching their eyes is just infrared light. Again, the animals can't see this light, so it doesn't affect them. Look how cool this is. All the youngsters, very, very, very much relaxed, just feasting away. Doing exactly what they do during the day, I suppose, is eat, 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 eat. An elephant needs to eat for 19 hours a day. Can you believe that? Luckily, we as humans don't have to eat that much. That would be quite a disaster, having to constantly feed. Can you imagine? Half the show would consist of us munching away in between the feeds. Hey, David? Though, I must say, that's David in the morning. And the amount of snacks that the cameramen bring with them on the morning safaris is amazing. It's fruit and cereal bars. What's your favorite snack, David?
Definitely a fruit.
A fruit. Which fruit?
I like a plum.
A plum.
Or a kiwi.
So there we go. So David's favorite snacks to bring with in the morning are either plums or kiwis. He does munch away on the cereal bars. He definitely does that. And I'm sure that an elephant would enjoy a cereal bar or a plum or a kiwi too. But we shall not give them any of those. They are wild and they need to find their own food. But they're all feeding on something specific. I'm not sure what exactly they're eating. Something that's growing down there. But we haven't got very much time left with you this afternoon on the Sunset Safari, coming down to the final seconds now. And I hope that you've enjoyed it. We've had an abundance of game again. We really have been spoilt today, the 18th of March. We have been blessed with lots and lots of wildlife. So from all of us here at Wild Earth, we are so happy that you keep watching. Keep sending in those questions, those screenshots, and we hope to see you all soon for the Sunrise Safari.